Physical properties are soil characteristics a grower can see or feel. Physical properties are neither chemical nor biological, but both affect them. Physical properties greatly affect how soils are used to grow plants or for other activities. Is the soil loose so roots can grow easily through it or water seep in easily? Or is the soil tight, preventing root growth and water absorption? How well does the soil aid in supplying air, water, and nutrients? Does the soil need irrigation or artificial drainage? Is this a good soil for apple trees or corn? Will the soil present problems for constructing a landscape retaining wall? A knowledge of physical properties helps to answer these questions. I'm Dr. DeBusk, and this video describes these properties beginning with the most basic one, soil texture. The most fundamental soil property, one that most influences other soil traits, is texture. Soil texture describes the proportion of three sizes of soil particles: sand, large; silt, medium; and clay, small. The size of soil particles, in turn, affects such soil traits as water holding capacity and aeration. Let us first describe why particle size affects these properties. Soil particle size affects two important soil features: specific surface area and the number and sizes of pores. We define specific surface area as the amount of surface area exposed by all the particles in a certain weight of soil. Specific surface area can be thought of as the internal surface area of the soil. The figure uses children's alphabet blocks to demonstrate that the smaller the particles in a soil, the larger the surface area. Because soil contains many small particles, a handful of soil may hold many thousand square feet of internal surface area. Soil surface area is important because reactions occur on the surface of soil particles and because water is held as a film around soil particles. Soils with greater surface area have more total water films. Imagine pouring water over a pile of marbles. Most of the water runs away quickly. Droplets clinging to the surface of the marbles are the only water retained in the pile because water cannot soak into the marbles. Following the rule about particle size, a pile of small beads holds more water than a pile of marbles because it has more surface area for water to cling to. Because soils with the smallest particles, like silt and clay, have the largest surface area, they hold the most moisture. Reactions that hold plant nutrients in the soil also occur on particle surfaces. Therefore, we can make the rule that the smaller the particles in a soil, the more water and nutrients the soil can retain. Pore size and number also depend on particle size. The figure suggests that more pores are found between small particles than between large ones. The figure also shows that pores are larger between larger particles. The soils high in clay have many small pores, while soils high in sand have fewer but larger pores. The larger pores, called macropores or aeration pores, create the easiest pathways and so largely determine the movement of air and water through the soil. As water drains down through the soil, it pulls air in behind it, which occupies the macropores. Small pores, or micropores, retain some water as it drains down through the soil. In such small pores, water films surrounding adjacent particles merge, holding water in place but excluding oxygen. Further, because of the small pore size, micropores make difficult pathways for water movement. Sometimes the larger micropores distinguish as mesopores, medium-sized pores that hold readily plant-available water. It is worth noting that macropores are fragile, sensitive to disturbance. These pores tend to collapse when compressed or exposed to tillage, even or especially by rototillers, reducing macroporosity. Soil scientists divide mineral particles into size groups called soil separates and define three broad classes: sand, silt, and clay. These three together make up the fine earth fraction of soil used to determine texture. Larger particles, such as gravel, are considered to be coarse fragments and are not considered in texture. The table names the separates and gives their sizes according to the system adopted by the United States Department of Agriculture, USDA. The comparison shows the difference by setting a very coarse sand grain equal to 3 feet in diameter. Sand the largest soil separate is composed mainly of weathered grains of quartz and other minerals. Sand particles are further divided into 5 subcategories as shown in the table. Individual sand grains, except for very fine ones, are visible to the naked eye. All are gritty to the touch. Sand grains do not stick to one another, so they act as individual grains in the soil. Enough sand in a soil creates large pores, so sand improves water infiltration, rate at which water enters the soil, and aeration. On the other hand, large amounts of sand lower the ability of the soil to retain water and nutrients. Silt is the medium-sized soil separate. Silt particles are silky or powdery to the touch, like talc. Like sand, silt grains do not stick to one another. Of all the soil separates, silt has the best ability to hold large amounts of water in a form plants can use. Silt, however, erodes readily in moving water and wind because of its size and lack of stickiness, which holds clay particles in place. Clay is the smallest soil separate, consisting mostly of tiny sheet-like crystals. Clay particles are about the size of particles in tobacco smoke. While sand and silt result simply from rock crumbling into small particles, clay results from chemical reactions between weathered minerals to form tiny particles of the new minerals. These new minerals are able to bond nutrients chemically to their surfaces, holding plant nutrients in the soil. Particles the size of clay, unlike larger ones such as silt or sand, can move through the soil, filtering between larger particles and moving water. This is a natural process of soil formation, an example of translocation and alluviation, which often leads to subsoils enriched in clay. Also, as a result, clay often appears as coatings on sand, silt, or larger soil units. Clay particles stick to one another and so do not behave as individual grains in soil. This helps prevent them from being carried away by wind and water. Wet clay is usually sticky and can be molded. Some types of clay swell when wet and shrink as they dry. Soils usually consist of more than one soil separate. All three are found in most soils. The exact proportion or percentage of all three separates is called soil texture. Obviously, any number of combinations of the three is possible, so soil scientists simplify texture by dividing soils into textural classes. Soils in the same textural class are similar. The 12 textural classes are shown in the soil triangle in the figure. Each side of the triangle represents the percentage of one soil separate. A person can measure the amount of sand, silt, and clay in a soil sample and simply read the class from the triangle. For example, if you have 40% sand, 38% silt, and 22% clay, the first step is to find 40% on the sand axis, and then draw a line parallel to the silt axis. The next step is to find either 38% silt or 22% clay. If you choose clay, look for 22% on the clay axis and draw a line parallel to the sand axis to intersect the previous line from the sand axis. The part of the triangle where the two lines intersect indicates the class of the soil texture. In this case, it would be classified as a loam. A loam is a soil in which sand, silt, and clay contribute equally to the soil properties. Sand particle size greatly influences soil properties. So for the sandier soil textures, the textural class name may be amended by noting the dominant sand fraction. One might have not just a sandy loam, but a coarse sandy loam. Not just a loamy sand, but a loamy fine sand. Also, in soils high in coarse fragments, the fragment name may be used as a modifier, as in gravelly loamy sand. Growers can usually manage soils without knowing the exact soil texture, so a broader classification is often adequate. One can simply classify soils as sandy, loamy, or clayey, as described previously. The figure shows another approach. The 12 classes are divided into 3 broad categories: coarse, medium, or fine, based on size of the soil separates. The amount of sand, silt, and clay in a soil can be measured by mechanical analysis. Mechanical analysis is based on the fact that the larger a soil particle, the faster it sinks in water. In mechanical analysis, one stirs soil into water and notes how fast soil particles settle out. This can be observed by performing a sedimentation test, in which one measures depth of sediment at various time intervals to determine percentage of sand, silt, and clay, or by using a hydrometer to measure water density at various time intervals. An even simpler test, which can be performed on site, is the ribbon or field test. The test is based on the feel of damp soil and how easily it can be molded. All who work with soil, including horticulturalists and landscape designers, should be able to perform ribbon testing. It is based on how long a ribbon can be formed from the sand before breaking. Soil scientists place soils in textural classes because each class has properties important to its management. One can only generalize about textural effects because other properties also affect the soil. However, here are a few useful guidelines. Texture governs the way water behaves in the soil. For instance, water enters infiltration and drains through percolation coarse soil most rapidly because of the large pore spaces. Thus, a coarse soil dries out most quickly after a heavy rain or in the spring, allowing a grower to get into the field more quickly. Similarly, coarse soils are more likely to need frequent irrigation. Growers with fine soils are likely to worry about the opposite problem, dealing with the excess water. Fine soils retain plant nutrients better than coarse soils. This is true partly because the rapid percolation of water through coarse soil leaches out nutrients. Also, clay particles have the best ability to retain nutrient chemicals. Soil texture influences how easily a soil can be worked. Because clay particles stick together, it takes more horsepower and fuel to pull tools such as plows through a fine soil. Landscapers also find it harder and slower to dig holes in fine soils for planting trees, so texture can even affect what should be charged for landscaping services. In fact, soil texture strongly affects many landscape practices, such as how to design a landscape irrigation system or a retaining wall. The stickiness of clay also affects the condition of the soil. For instance, fine soils often form clods when they are tilled. A crust may also form on the surface and interfere with seedling emergence. A fine soil tends to be tight, meaning it has mostly small pores that are difficult for air and roots to penetrate. In contrast, coarse soils are loose and well aerated. Clayey soils tend to retain more soil organic matter than sandy soils, which lends them a darker color. The higher organic matter content also makes them a stronger carbon sink, so efforts to sequester carbon will be most effective in finer texture soils. For most purposes, growers consider medium soils to be ideal. They hold water, but they do not stay wet too long. They are neither sticky nor hard to work. In general, medium soils have good traits of both coarse and fine soils without their bad traits. Growers and engineers use soils for many purposes. For each purpose, a different soil texture may be best. For example, corn tends to be most productive on a loam, potatoes on a sandy loam, and black walnuts on fine textured soils. Loamy soils are easiest to use for landscapes and gardens. Can a grower change soil texture to improve it for the crop being grown? Except in very small areas such as golf greens or potting soils, changing texture is impractical. The amounts of clay or sand to be added are too large. The figure shows the effect of adding sand to a clay soil to loosen it. Clay particles surround the sand grains and fill in any pores that may be created. As a result, the soil continues to behave much like clay. To greatly modify clay, enough sand must be added to make the sand grains touch each other and form bridges that exclude clay from the pores between the sand grains. A better way to improve clay soils is to add organic matter, a practice described repeatedly elsewhere in this video series. There are three ways for growers to take texture into account. First, select a crop to fit the soil or purchase land that suits the crop. For example, an apple grower may purchase land with a fine soil on which apples grow best. In many landscapes, a sugar maple, Acer saccharum, will not thrive on a sandy soil, while a red maple, Acer rubrum, might do well. An axiom of landscape design is put the right plant in the right place, and texture is an element of that. Second, manage the soil in a manner that fits the texture. For example, with proper fertilization and irrigation, coarse soils can be very productive. A sugar maple may grow on sand if well watered. When planting landscape trees in Minnesota, many landscapers plant high in heavy clay soils. That is, the top of the root ball will be a couple of inches above grade, with a bit of soil added around to make a low mound. This improves aeration and reduces excess wetness around the roots in these difficult heavy soils. Third, organic matter can improve texture extremes by making sandy soils less droughty and more fertile and by loosening clay soils. The third choice might be considered one of the cardinal rules of soil management: add organic matter to improve soil. It might be pointed out that adding organic matter does not actually change soil texture itself. Think about the definition of soil texture to determine why. It does, however, modify another powerful physical property to be discussed in another video, soil structure. In conclusion, the most basic physical property of soil is texture, the proportion of sand, silt, and clay. Texture strongly affects how growers use soil.